Yes, we nearly had technical difficulties here before, so which was quite apt actually, because the talk I was going to have to do, the computer wasn't going to work, so I would have had to do it ad lib, which actually I think some people forget about that. We rely so much on technology and we get so used to stuff. And my talk's a little bit about that. Little do, big do. For those of you who don't know, I work in work in the same business that David used to work in. I've been trying to get out of it for the last 25 years and David's managed it. And David's actually a much better doer than I am. I'm not really a doer, so I don't quite know why I'm talking here. Throughout my life, I've relied heavily on other people to do most of the things that people think that I've done. So I sort of went back and I thought about there's little do's and big do's, and I tend to like doing big do's because I'm a sort of dreamer, and often those don't happen. Whereas little do's, you should all be able to do. So my first question is it downwards or is it to the right? How technical am I? It's a space button. Right. What have these three people got in common? That's my first question. This is, if you don't know, this is Great Uncle Bulgaria from the Wombles. This is Wallace from Wallace and Gromit. And that's my dad. And all three of them were doers. They all used to make things out of recycled bits and bobs. And I spent my life living in a house, not realising at the time when I was a child that everything around me was sort of made by my dad. So, little do's. My dad built a lot of stuff, but he originally had an engineering brain. That's him on the back. He married into my mother's family, which actually, if you go back, started Atco Lawnmowers. And he was the managing director of the Birmingham branch. And when Flymo came along, Atco missed it. And it was the sort of demise of Atco, and my dad lost his job. He spent the next 10 years in his workshop. And he used to just collect anything. He would never throw anything away. His main sort of things that he really liked using all the time were like rubber bands, coat hangers, anything to build stuff. And he sort of tried to invent things that he thought might be able to sell. But actually, what he really did was start building stuff for himself. So this is an early video of the bird scarer in the kitchen garden. He was an environmentalist, which I didn't really realise at the time, but he was very careful about not wanting to sort of frighten animals. You know, you could go out with a gun and shoot them. But this was, you can see, was his second test. So he painted the peregrine falcon and I can't remember quite, the kite, I think it is, a red kite on Corex, and then balanced it. And when the wind picks up, it goes round and supposedly frightens all the animals. So I wish I'd spent more time with my dad and filmed him a lot more, because he left. We used to live in this sort of old, big old wall, sort of old rectory, and everything in the house was done, and we never went round and filmed it, because as a child I used to just want my dad to be normal. You know, why can't we go to the pub and play football like other dads? And then you lose it. So I've drawn some of his inventions. This is a scale plan of the bathroom, and his bathroom had two doors. And obviously when you go to the toilet, it was quite difficult. You had to get up, lock that door and lock that door. So he took a bit of fishing wiring, salmon fishing wiring, attached it to the lock on one door, drilled a hole in the roof, attached the other lock down the other way, and then in the roof joined the two. But the main thing was we were having problem with some pigeons which were roosting in the roof. So he took some old bells from like the maid's bells that you get in an old house and had them in the roof. So every time he shut the door, you could just hear this. The theory was that the birds would fly out of the roof. Obviously they got used to the music and never did, but the principle was there. Most of the doors in their houses, because my dad refused to pay heating bills, because being unemployed for 10 years, we didn't have much money. With five kids as well. My mother thought that's why she started the kitchen garden, and it became a bit like the good life. But he wanted to make sure that he hated when we left doors open. So he would like rig up these pulley systems with wire on that would shut the doors behind you. And my mother got very, very irritated because this was actually the main room into the living room. And guests would come round and there was this car piston here. This is hanging on a wire. And she'd say, Michael, God, you can't even, you've got guests coming. And so he'd say, OK, I'll sort it out. And this is actually a piece of drain pipe that he then installed. So you can't see the car piston. And then he would just wrap a bit of metal around the handle and then a bit of string down to a block of wood. And this was if you were carrying a tray of food into the... You could do this, the handle went down, you go through the door and then the door shuts behind you. So, saving some heat. So this, I'm going to speed up a bit. This was, I came home from college with some friends one night. This is one of those rather large wheelbarrows printed. He had nailed a door to the top of it, so he couldn't get into it. And then he had taken the top of a slide, an old slide, and drilled that onto it. That's a bit of rope in the middle. And these were two sort of pointed wooden legs that he had attached. And I had to try and guess what it was when I came back. It had little shavings of green over it. And what he had done is, and this is sort of sums up my dad. He would build these things. This probably took him like, you know, 2 weeks to work out and build. And actually in those 2 weeks, he could have actually done the job that this thing does. But anyway, we had a long, long garden hedge, a long hedge, with which very fast growing. And he had to trim it. And he hated the fact that he had to get on a ladder, climb up the ladder, trim a bit of hedge, get down the ladder, move the ladder. So he would stand on the back of this thing. He would tie a rope, the rope to an apple tree at the end of this thing. And he could sort of surf like that. So he'd go like that and pull himself along and not have to go down the ladder. But also he was aerating the soil because we had quite difficult clay. So yeah, I know, Matt. So moving house didn't really help him. My mum and his parted and he ended up in a new house and he started being, he had all these remote controls, he's a big video geek, but he used to lose them all, so he just stuck them all together and built these sort of, you know, just mad things. I mean, this was the old dustbin lid is to stop squirrels getting onto the bird table and the use of hose pipe to stop heavy birds being able to get at the food, so it would just tilt and... You know, starting lawnmowers was much easier if you rigged it up so you could start it with a drill. This lawnmower is like, these are 30 years old. He didn't throw things away. I remember the dishwasher being like 35 years old and he'd reinforced it with fiberglass or whatever. You know, he sort of had that mentality. And I think people of his era just knew how to do stuff more with their hands. And I worry that our kids aren't sort of growing up like that, really. So my brother did actually, fortunately, film some of my dad's inventions. After 10 years and sort of threatening of the family breakup, he eventually took a job travelling around the world, travelling around Britain, collecting used watch batteries for silver reclamation. It was a very kitchen industry. Someone came into the village and my dad started being the office boy and then travelled around collecting them and bringing them back so people could smelt them. But on his journey, obviously, he found different problems. This was one of the problems he found, going to bed and breakfast.
The just dropped on the floor. The Mark II toothpaste borrower. What do you do when you've got your toothpaste tube empty? You find somebody who's got a fuller tube. You screw... Oh, wait a minute. Just come off. I'm sorry, I got that bit wrong. That part you take off. You screw on the toothpaste borrower, Mark II. And find somebody else's toothpaste, in this case Fiona's, but it doesn't really matter who, she's always borrowing my stuff, and screw that in. The other end. Now then, the big moment has arrived. I'll do it sideways on. Squeeze! 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 I think I've been a bit greedy, I've borrowed rather a lot. There we are.
And it's sort of... You know, then you come and I sort of look at my own sort of the work I've been involved around and I've got people to help me. I've got like directors, I've got photographers, I've got like puppeteers, I've got animators. And it's sort of frustrating sometimes to think that my father was way more talented than me, much more of a doer, had much more sort of, you know, equally as many ideas, but he made them happen. He asked me to come into his bedroom once, you know, he did, and lie on the bed with him. And what he'd done was he'd blacked out his window. This was quite a while ago. He'd blacked out his window with sugar paper and turned it into a camera obscura. So he'd worked out that the way that the bedroom was facing was perfect, and the whole street reflected in the morning on the roof. And I've seen artists do it now. He's getting quite a lot of acclaim about 10 years ago. But this was a long while ago, and I was going, you know, if he had the, he could have turned it into black blinds, and you pull the black blinds down in your kid's bedroom, and it just projects the whole, because most bedrooms actually face the right way. And it wasn't that his ideas weren't marketable. I came back once, he was in the bath, covered in oil, like he'd filled the bath with sort of cooking oil. And this is half an ice cream container with two bits of wood and four drawing pins. And he often used a cigarette lighter a lot to work with. And he had melted the edge here of the, so it drooped over. And what he had seen in Kuwait when all the wars were going on and all the disasters, all the birds he'd seen covered in oil. He was really, he was a big sort of big bird watcher. And he said, I'm going to work out how to save, get rid of the oil slicks. And this thing, basically, it worked out that it tips and the oil goes over the lip and then it rewrites and you burn the oil off. And he sent two bits of wood, four drawing pins, some scribbled handwriting and an ice cream container to BP. And he got a nice letter, but you know. I think they said, oh, how does it work in rough seas? So he was working on that, but you know, didn't do it. So, you know, I like big do's and I don't get many of them done. But it's like we call them big, hairy, audacious goals. And I think to do big do's, you do have to often have people around you or you connecting. I mean, it's interesting, the new world and the web and just what you can do now if you can't actually do something. This was a big do I'm trying to do at the moment, which is quite mad. So I made this little bit of film. So I've always liked architecture and I like big ideas. I thought the eighth wonder of the world was quite a challenge. A lot of the wonders of the world were built for specifics, whether it was the Great Wall of China or something. And I sort of thought, what would a building be now if we were trying at this time, this moment in time, what should it be? And obviously it should be completely self-sustainable, but what more could it do? What could it be an educational thing? And this was the very, very original scribble for it. I loved the idea of sort of doing a giant sundial, but that was an actual educational centre, but it actually worked like a sundial. So it was a building, but you needed a lot of sun for that. What I'm not is an architect, so I don't really understand quite how architecture works. But I Skyped this guy, Casper Morkulnis in San Francisco, and he said, yeah, I'd like to have a go at doing something, sounds an interesting project, but you're going to need a lot of sun. So he got an intern and they said, you know, he was suggesting you know, you need to go to the Far East. Dubai's lost most of its money because it's not going to be a cheap project. Abu Dhabi would be the place to probably go. But the thing is, over there, sundials don't work like they do in the Northern Hemisphere. So you have to look at an equatorial sundial, which is at 45 degrees. So we based the building on that. But the idea of the fascia actually being something that could tell the time was sort of part of my little pet project, because I like to do that as an idea. But we in order to make the building completely self-sustainable, we need to have a trough for water. So the building developed the shape of it. Obviously, the when you're making monuments to wealth, you normally make them upwards, like giant penises. I don't think we need any more of those, personally. That's the tallest building in the world, just currently being finished, Brunei, 800 metres. Ours is going to be three times taller, only we're going to do it along the ground, because we need a lot of solar cells. A lot of this is actually the sundial bit, this little peak bit off the middle. But the building has to be completely self-sustainable, so it goes around, like it'll have a grey water site and the far side tree transport. I mean, it's just a circular thing. So it's a bit like, I want it to be like when you go to the science museum, you can see how things are working. And when you go to this building, you should, it's going to be an open source environmental technologies building. So if you walk in, this bit here, just this bit here, is like sort of, you know, the size of Canary Wharf. I mean, the tower. This is huge. And it would take you a long time to walk from here to here in order to see the needle that would be off here. But you should be able to see your energy being trapped as you walk. So your actual walking is creating energy. Obviously, we would take a lot of the world's rarest plants and try and keep growing them there. But the Open Technology Centre, I think, is where people anywhere all over the world can go and improve. So the building should be a living building that actually can improve itself and its environment around it. And it will power, it will be the world's largest solar power station. But it should power more than just itself. It should power a lot of the area around it as well. I mean, I don't know technically. I've been talking to Casper about what we can do. But that's sort of a big, hairy, audacious goal. The only thing we haven't got is an investor. So we're trying to get to the princes of Abu Dhabi, and if anyone knows them, you can call that. But the nice thing is, this is the little advertising bit of me. So when you're flying in, the pilot can not only tell you about the eighth wonder of the world, but the eighth wonder of the world can tell you what time it is as you fly by to land in Abu Dhabi. So that's. My dad passed away about 3 years ago now, two, 3 years ago. And I think anybody who has something like that happen to them, it sort of just jolts you a bit and you go, oh, that's strange, we're not all invincible. And I think as a creative person, you always like have a little thing in you. It's I don't know whether it's an arrogance thing. I think as creative people, you want to leave something on your, it's your legacy, what you leave behind you that you normally want. And I'm in danger sometimes, I think, of having here lies Tony Davidson, who sold washing powder to people, or, you know. So I started to think about, was there an opportunity to do a little do where you actually have to get on and do it yourself? And I collect things for no reason. And I'd collected photographs of pictures of things that just make me laugh and look like sort of breasts sort of thing. And I just sort of collected them. And I don't know, I've collected them for about 10 years and I don't know why I collected them. I think part of the creative process is you collect lots of things. You know, when digital cameras come in, I used to collect broken wing mirrors on cars. And, you know, I think Paul Smith, I think, always collects stuff and surrounds him with it and doesn't know why. And then suddenly goes, oh yeah, it's part of the process. So I suddenly thought, can I do something with those photographs? And so I went around with a dictaphone and started interviewing men from different walks of life and just getting them to tell me why, because there was this sort of obvious thing, oh, all men like big breasts, you know. And I thought, well, it's not true, I'm not like that, and I wonder what it is. And he went around and there was just a really interesting diversity of people that you, and what their opinions were about them. And then I started taking those quotes and sticking them next to the photographs that seemed to fit them best. And then fortunately, my MD's wife was heard about it, and she worked for a publishing thing. And now, last Christmas, a book came out, and all the money that profits go from are going to go to cancer research and breast cancer. My dad died of, well, had prostate cancer, so I'd like to do some for that as well. I haven't got past the initial level of book sales that you need to get to beyond, so I have got a copy here if anybody wants to read it. Little sales thing, if you do, all I ask is that you go on the customer reviews and say it's rubbish or it's good or whatever, but and try and think, and maybe we'll get a few more sales at this Christmas. But I think it was really rewarding to do something yourself. I had it all on the kitchen wall with my girlfriend sort of ran, sort of shouting at me going, come on, get on and do it, you know, and it had the pictures and the quotes, and I'm a tinkerer, so I kept on changing that word with that word, and eventually it had to get out the door. And that's something I think that I'm very bad at, because I'm a perfectionist, so I like to get things really right before I let them out. Whereas in the new world, I think you need to let things out a lot more readily, you know, earlier, and you can change them as you go along. And I'm trying to do that. So the main things I think at my talk I'd like to think about are: make sure you don't throw everything away. My dad kept everything, and I think we can do a lot with the stuff we have. Don't forget that you can do, if you're doing little do's, you should do it yourself. I'm pretty much of a technophobe, and I need to dive in a lot more, but make sure you do things. Don't be scared of things. It's because if you are scared of doing something, you'll learn something each time. You make mistakes, but keep doing it. And when if it is a big do and it's an outrageous do, find out people who are interested in that conversation and go and find them online. Go and find them, talk to people, because people are incredibly giving, I think, at the moment in this society. And you can get big do's. You know, I talked about that building at the Google Zeitgeist lectures, and the Prince of Norway came up afterwards, and a guy from Dubai came up, who I'm still in touch with, and they give you a card and they tell you to ring this. I mean, I know David always does it with a cup of tea, and he just, if he wants to go and meet someone, he just goes, hey, I'm a guy, I run a company, do you fancy a cup of tea? And, you know, but I mean, Paul Smith came and saw you, and I think it, you know, don't be scared of involving people and almost letting stuff go sometimes. Sometimes we protect our ideas too much. But the main thing of all is obviously to start, because that is the hardest thing. I think if you start something, then it drives the momentum. I think if you're always worrying about what it's going to look like at the end, you sometimes won't start. And starting's the most important thing. And if any of you are lovers of golf, as my father was, he didn't really like spending money because he was Scottish and liked saving it, and would like to patent this, you're free to do so. Connector.
Itself, which is good. The shots were straight. If they weren't straight, the ball wouldn't have gone back straight. That was bottom. That was bottom.
That's what I call recycling.